believe in preparation. But there's sometimes where your preparation, your studying, I did not study none this week. Not one at all. And because I was in deep consecration and in preparation. And there comes a time where you just come, you just sit, and you must hear God say. There comes a time where you just must get still and trust God. If you don't hear nothing, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Please, Bishop. You don't need to come up with anything. No premeditated messages. You wait to hear from God. And when God speaks to you, no one can contradict it. Because if any man speak, let him speak as though he was oracles of God. I just want to hear from God. Tired of coming in and just I need some substance. I need to hear from the throne of God, because there's something that I need specifically for God to speak into my spirit. Everybody can't preach to you. Everybody can't speak a word into your life. When you are going through something, you need to hear a fresh word. Need to know that it's from God.
Amen.
Yes, it is.
So, hear the word that God has given me. Out of Esther, the first chapter, is that when you change your values, your enemy must respect your anointing. When you change your values, the enemy must respect your anointing.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
When you look at the contents of the book of Esther, it does not really say anything about God. But it is a book that actually has a lot of insight, and it shows the providence of God's presence upon his people. And it does not make a difference people's perception or the feelings concerning you as an individual. Long as you know who you are, you know what God has called you to do. I was a stubborn in school. They used to pick with me all the time. But I knew I was going to be stubborn all my life. But when I got the right training, then they left me alone. You see, when the Bible says when Jesus and the devil came up, amen, he left Jesus alone because he knew that everything that he tried just would not work.
Amen.
It is so unique that in the corporate field, that those are the secretaries, not some of these ladies, but men, they're the secretaries. They're things that people do in order to climb the corporate ladder. In order to get grades, or to get GS-234, or to get extra raise or something of that nature. The things that people do in that aspect, in order to climb the corporate ladder at the expense of demoralizing themselves. Mm-hmm. Even in the ministry field, the things that preachers do. I've been through that. I don't have a problem being transparent. Things that we do to try to get appointments and try to get known, try to get out there. We position ourselves with hope and expectation that someone will select you. Been there, then done that. One person got upset with me because I said that I don't swing on the poles. You got to be careful. Young folks, too much damage control has to be done. And then when you just get tired of that, you know, you're like, why have I been doing these things? I'm demoralizing myself because if you think about it, if people can't respect you and love you for who you are, then why are we doing things for people to accept you? Praise Bishop. I feel like I'm in the Baptist church, but it's all right. I'm going to go over anyway. But it's so unique that the things that people do, then there is a reality that we must come to grips with. And so whether you're not needed, bow-legged, bar-headed, eagle-nested, of life, trying to make people accept them. Trying to please folks. That's why when Leah lived with Jacob, Jacob never could love her. He loved things about her. But when he woke up in the morning, he saw that it was not Rachel. He lost it. He said, this can't be Rachel because Rachel got straight eyes. She got eyes on both ways. She gave him several children. And yet, he showed no emotion. Something was wrong with Jacob. Anytime you can, or something was wrong with her. Because you came with your past. There's not a reciprocity. Yeah. It's not reciprocated. Come on, preach, Bishop. And things like that happen.
Yeah.
Unfortunately. And but the struggle that we pass through, the things that we go through mentally, they're so challenging. What it does to your spirit, what it does to your mind, what it does to you as an individual, it hurts you. It does something emotionally. Some folks I see in school, you know, coming up, how you have the petite ones and you have the thick ones.
I say fat. I say thick. Petite, small, petite, medium, thick.
Yeah. Nice.
And you know that there's always someone that wants to pick on somebody else.
Oh, yes, sir.
And yet the one that they're picking on is so educated and so blessed, making them 4.0, and then they're just really mad. They're hitting on them, not so much as because of how they look, but they're hating on them because of their gift.
Hallelujah.
One thing that they can never take away from Tina. Tina and I had it going on.
Good God Almighty.
But Tina got to the pond. I thought they're supposed to get the cake all in her face. She said, no more. Eat the cake. Tina said, no. When they had to go to court, Tina said, listen. You done beat me up, you put the cake in my face. I don't know if it was rum cake, I don't know if it was cheese, I don't know what it was. But Tina in the court, she said, listen. Her lawyer looked at her and said, Tina, are you crazy? You mean to tell me that you're gonna give up everything? Tina said, yeah, he can have the court, he can have all of that.
What do you want? What do you want, Tina? What do you want, people? What do you want, ma'am, sir, boy, girl? What do you want?
She said, I just want my name. That's all I want. But he can't lose my last name. Because she knew that she could build upon what was her in the beginning.
Yes.
That's one thing that nobody should ever take away from you. It's your gift.
But she was doing so well with everything that she had. People all around the
24/7. She had no need. She had no spoil. She was with the sugar daddy. She had everything going on in her life, but she lost her identity.
Yes. Yes.
Thanks, Bishop. Yeah, I'm gonna go. I thought the sisters would jump up and do something. That's all right. She was this lady. Woke up. This man woke up. So I'm going to switch to the man because y'all even trying to help me. Sorry. This lady, this man woke up and realized something here, because the dance that Vashti practiced, it was called the Herodias dance. It was a dance that was not practiced by everybody. It was a dance that you had to be trained by the most demonistical, high-ranking demonic force to learn the Herodias dance. It was the same dance that the Pharaoh's brother's wife practiced in order to get John's head, because that was a dance, glory to God, that can get a man's head if he can hit anything that she wanted.
Yeah. Wow.
That must have been some kind of dance.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That must have been some kind of dance.
Yeah.
That stands that we hold those folks on doing the church. That's that funny kind of dance. That's that stuff that moves all over the place. We don't want that kind of dance in the church.
Yeah.
No, not here.
Yeah.
But this woman, who was never looked upon, even among preachers in my constituents, not really preached about because they viewed Vashti as this person that had no good morals about themselves, or someone that just did not have no good character about herself. It's so unique that how we can judge an individual on the outside. Man looks on the outward appearance, but God sees the heart. Yes, I may not have a car, may not have no money, may not have a job, but I'm a child of God. Decided that she would not go. She defied not only the king, but she defied a husband. Now, I've got to be balanced. Don't get mad at me. I've got to be balanced. I don't understand this. She's not only being disobedient to the king, but now she's disobeying husband. So how does this thing work here? Because the Bible says, so Christ loved the church, so much husband wants to love his wife, and that the wife must be subject, not in some place, but in all.